engage patients and ultimately reduce variability and costs. And on the panel today, we have experts from a variety of industries who are here to really share their insights that are unique to their companies and sets of experiences. And I think this is a really interesting area, particularly around areas like genomics, where massive amounts of data are really required to move forward on the healthcare technology side. So with that, let's have the panelists introduce themselves. If you want to start off.
Sure, I'm Dr. Andy Litt. I'm the Chief Medical Officer for Dell Healthcare and Life Sciences. I'm a neuroradiologist by training and a former hospital executive. Dell is heavily involved in healthcare, much more than people know, and not just around selling laptops and tablets and whatever, but we do everything from complete IT outsourcing to having 7 billion radiology images in our cloud. We like to say we have more data, healthcare data in the cloud than anybody else in the country. To doing personalized medicine. We have a project with genomics, treating kids with cancer, with an incurable cancer, using genomics and high-speed computing and genomics data storage in the cloud to treat those kids. So it's kind of a very broad range. We work with both the provider side, hospitals, doctors, et cetera, the payer side, insurance companies, the government, and finally the life sciences companies, pharma, big tech, biotech, et cetera.
Yeah, and I'm Roger Foster. I'm the founder of a new startup called ValityX, which is value and analytics, primarily focused on the healthcare problem of value-based healthcare, and we're specifically focused on the financial side and the costing. I got into this after building a 225-person health IT consulting firm, which we sold about 2 years ago, and it was quite clear, you know, in doing the sort of EHR and all the program management support around implementing health IT, that the big fear was, once you got these EHRs, you know, in place, what are you going to actually do with them? And the real problem was around the analytics. And when we dove into the analytics, you know, the challenge is not just understanding the outcome side, but
they're working with top companies in America, Fortune 100, Fortune 500 companies. When it comes to healthcare, our focus is largely on, right now we are focusing largely on analytics because that happens to be the main problem in healthcare. Healthcare field is just opening up to big data. So that's it.
Great. Okay, so the way we'll run this panel is we have about 5 questions or so that we've thought about as a group. And so I'd like to go through those fairly quickly, and panelists will jump in on questions where they'd like to weigh in on the topic, and then we'll open it up to questions after that. That sounds good. So I'd like to start out by taking pulse of the situation or the topic at hand and hear from the panelists what or rather how big data and analytics has the greatest impact on their roles today and where they see that going over the next few years.
Yeah, so I would say that, you know, big data, analytics, like in the conversation that was in the prior panel, it's just kind of getting started. I mean, people are kind of feeling their way in. As anybody who works in healthcare knows, the primary focus for the last several years has been just to get everything digital. And we're still clinical decision support, bringing data to the point of care to let doctors, caregivers make better decisions about a particular patient using all the analytic capabilities. Population health, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, in terms of how do you look at this broad population of patients, you know, this 500 diabetics or 2,000 people with heart failure or something, and how do you change up the quality and lower the cost for those people? And the final thing, which I hope we can get to come back to because it tends to get lost, is what I would call the standard business process analytics. I'm sure the stuff that Ashutosh does for retail and big finance companies, etc. Healthcare is a horribly inefficient industry. And if we could just get a little bit more productivity, a little bit more efficiency, there's a lot of money that could be saved. You know, we spend $2.5 trillion in this country on healthcare a year, and McKinsey estimates we could save 20% of that using big data and analytics. So that's $500 billion. That's a lot of money.
Yeah, I actually think it's a little bit bigger than that. I did some research and some reviews. There's an article, I think, by Thomson Reuters probably 3 or 4 years ago, where they looked at inefficiencies in the healthcare system and kind of broke it down into 6 major buckets. And one of the biggest inefficiencies is just basically the unwarranted use of healthcare. In other words, we're not very good at knowing what works and what doesn't. So just being able to use analytics to understand what's actually creating a beneficial outcome, I mean, that's a huge potential savings. I think that number is somewhere around $300 billion, at least according to that one survey. There's another area which is fraud and abuse, at least from the government side, CMS with Medicare and Medicaid. I think they're looking at something in the order of $150 billion a year in Medicaid fraud. So there's a huge opportunity for the application of analytics there. There's a big inefficiency, again, of around $150 billion in administrative inefficiencies between payers and providers. And I think one of the things that you're going to see driving forward is how's that relationship between payers and providers going to converge? So there's a big opportunity for analytic application there. There's lots of inefficiencies at the provider level in terms of things like medical errors. So this is, again, another $50 to $100 billion in potential improvement there. There's patient care coordination. I think that's another $50 billion size opportunity. And then there's preventable conditions, again, between $25 and $50 billion. So all of that adds up to, you know, almost $1 trillion of potential inefficiencies. Now, clearly, the analytics isn't going to capture all of that, but it's going to help drive a lot of the structural changes I think are going to occur in the healthcare industry much more rapidly than has changed in the past, driven primarily by the use of digital data.
Great. Well, with that, why don't we move on to the next healthcare question? Which is thinking about the biggest hurdle that our panelists face in actually using data in their roles today. And I think that there are a number of ways to look at this question. It could be as simple as, how do you standardize data? How do you aggregate data from different sources? Who owns the data? I mean, these are all basic questions that haven't really been solved for, so I'd love to hear any thoughts around that.
Yeah, I'll jump in. This is Daniel from DrChrono. So, if you look at the healthcare landscape, you see all these hospitals that are out there and all of these large health organizations, and things aren't really moved to the cloud yet in healthcare. It's sort of a delayed move to that. If you look at what they're buying, there's large pieces of software that are multiple millions of dollars, and they'll do an install in one location, and that's for that one location. So they'll have an army of consultants go in, really brilliant developers, and they'll focus on one place. And really the cloud, I think, as we see the future ahead, we're gonna see a lot of these organizations moving to the cloud. And it's really, part of the challenge is, how do you take this hospital, that hospital, that hospital, that have all these different installs, and it might even be the same software, how do they communicate better? So, the challenge for the larger companies out there is, how do I make this install and this install and this install all the same so they can communicate? And it's a huge challenge because, the hospital institutions and the other institutions out there, do they really want all that data share, right? They're also looking at it as a business, and it's one of those things where it's very complicated. It's not just the technology. There's people involved in sharing this data. The approach at our company is, how do we approach it like Apple did, right? You create a simple platform, you let anybody build on it and access that data. Yes, there's other hurdles to get over, but if you look at the way that Apple did it, is anybody could build an app, and they could release that app to 100 people, and then Apple looks at it and says, okay, this app is stable enough to release into the Apple ecosystem, and once it's there, you can leverage all this different data from all these different tools on an Apple device, and I see healthcare can move that way. It's just a matter of moving it all to the cloud. And that's a huge challenge. And I think if we move all of it to the cloud, it opens up a lot of interesting gateways. I don't know if anybody wants to jump in.
So, this is Ashutosh from Impetus. I think one of the biggest challenges that the big data industry is facing, apart from technical challenges, is how to bring down the cost. See, right now, let's take America for example. The median income in America is $49,000 per year, right? A new drug comes to market, say for cancer, is one of the biggest concerns. The cost of the 1 year usage of drug is, let's say, $63,000. This is a real example. So more than 60-70% of the population can simply not access that drug. Now the big challenge is how to bring that cost down. And the big one of the big hurdles as the previous panel was discussing is adoption. A lot of the technology already exists. In other industries, we are using many of the technologies that the healthcare industry is facing. And there are many complexities in case of healthcare. But I think our focus area should be individual in how big data can help an individual, the person on the ground, how they get benefited from all the technology that already exists. I think that's one of the big challenges.
Well, let's just move on for the sake of time, if that's all right. And I think talking about all these challenges paints a little bit of a picture of gloom, but I want to stay in that theme for a second by just thinking about the implications of privacy and security as a challenge. And what does that mean practically in your roles in companies today, and what's top of mind in that category?
Yeah, so I think that's of all the challenges, I think that and sort of culture, and the two are related, are probably the most important, because health data is unlike any other data, including financial data. It's the data that people in every survey that's ever been done say they care about the most. They take a risk with their finances. They don't want their healthcare data going out there because they're worried about their job, they're worried about insurance, they're worried about their friends finding out about things, et cetera. So we have a real obligation as the health IT industry to really protect this data more than any other. And that comes from everything from securing the devices. You know, most of the healthcare data that's released or inadvertently gets out today is not because of some hacker. There's a lot of that, and I'll talk about that in a second. But most of it, over half, is because somebody leaves an unencrypted thumb drive or a laptop or an iPad or whatever, and they lose it, or it gets stolen, or it's left on the subway, or whatever. That's where most of the data loss is coming today. So that's culture. I mean, we have the technology to encrypt hard drives. I mean, that's not something that's new technology. This is about just culture, about people taking this seriously. But the other half of it, and we have a big security business at Dell, and a big part of that is securing data for hospitals as well as financial institutions, et cetera. Most hospitals have taken the view that, well, I have a firewall, so that means I'm safe, which is kind of a very primitive view. And our teams look at it, the most susceptible industry right now to the professional or criminal hacking group, meaning not the kids who are in their basement, but the people who do this for a living, many of whom are overseas, is actually healthcare. It's the soft underbelly, it's easy to get in, and by the way, once you break into the IT system of a hospital, just think of all the places you can go. It's connected to the government through Medicare, it's connected to insurance companies, it's connected to the CDC, there's all kinds of places you can go that's interesting. The value of a healthcare record, a stolen healthcare record, on the quote-unquote black market is about $50. By the way, the value of a social security number is only $5, so it's worth 10 times more.
Wow. Well, we spoke a moment ago about adoption as a challenge, and I'd like to go into that a little bit more by thinking about how the panelists think that healthcare, well, the business of healthcare, will change as adoption progresses going forward.
Yeah, I'll make a couple of comments on that. I think from a provider industry perspective, you know, providers, hospitals, are actually really low margin businesses. like the average hospital, if it's actually making money, is only running at about a 2% gross margin. So it's a little bit like the grocery store business. A whole lot of revenue, but not a lot of profit coming out of it. I think HIMSS Analytics did a recent survey of several thousand provider organizations. And there's a very strong correlation between maturity in terms of level of use of analytics and profitability of that provider organization. So there's a real opportunity for hospital provider organizations to start using analytics to directly affect their financial profit. So I think that's one big area. I think there's another corollary to that, and I call this the healthcare hunger games, which is if you actually look at the dynamics that's going on in the provider, we've got something like 5,000 hospitals in the US. And if you roll forward 5 to 10 years, you're probably gonna see 1,000 of those hospitals just disappear because they're really no longer financially viable. I mean, that's putting a lot of pressure. If you're a CFO or CEO of one of these provider organizations, you're under a tremendous amount of pressure to figure out, you know, how are you gonna be one of the surviving provider organizations. That's having just, you know, huge effects on the dynamics. And again, I think the analytics is going to be important to these leaders as they make really tough business decisions about, you know, what do I do with my organization? What part of the business am I going to be in? Am I going to be in business now? So there's a big challenge there.
Yeah, definitely.
When it comes to security and privacy, I think we have made some very hopeful step. We have taken some very hopeful steps forward. We have seen a couple of very interesting developments, particularly with Obamacare, and now that the results are coming out, many companies are declaring their profits for the first quarter and so on. So I think that some of these concerns will be increasingly taken care of as policymakers are being more and more aware about these issues, and they see a big opportunity in terms of population health, in terms of individual and personalized care. So I think I see a lot of hope when it comes to complications related to
100 million records, but they certainly got 10. And you can provide doctors with data about their patients and their performance compared to their peers. Guess what? Doctors are really competitive. And they don't want to be, you know, at the low end of the performance scale. So they're gonna adopt those best practices so that their patients do as well as, you know, their colleague down the street or something.
So this is actually this is a very much talked about and very known thing. So I agree with what all you are saying. I just like to add another comment from. So last year I was at Strata RX there, and there during one of the keynote sessions, you know, Khosla made a lot of noise by, he upset a lot of people, I think, by saying that if we keep moving ahead the way we are moving right now, in coming 10 to 15 years, and I'm paraphrasing him, that almost 80% of the current healthcare staff will not be needed. The analytics can go so much ahead with the help of technology that you will need a lot of MDs, you will need a lot of other healthcare staff, but a lot of the heavy lifting can be done with help of quality research and that is useful on ground. So population health is a very big thing and a low-hanging fruit.
I just want to comment on this because this stuff drives me crazy. I absolutely disagree with that. I think population health is really important. I work for a technology company, I believe in the technology that we do and that everybody on this panel does, but we don't have enough medical knowledge yet, maybe in 30 years or 50 years, probably more like 50. Just think about how the recommendations are always changing about what best practices are or whatever. It's just, we're not there yet to make this a pure analytic. And just the way, you know, you think about financial services where they've been doing this for 25 years. And you still have good stock pickers and bad stock pickers, right? And you think, well, we know everything about stocks, right? We should be able to pick them 100% by the technology. And they certainly do a lot, but not 100%. It's not all going away. I think what's going to be important is the ability of physicians and other caregivers to be trained to use these technologies in a way to enhance what they do, and not to rely on just the way, you know, what they learned back in medical school.
There's a symbiotic relationship between the provider and the decision system.
Let me just comment briefly. So, I'm a data scientist, right? I analyze data. I see that data. I see the potential of that data. So I don't know if it will be 5 years, 15 years, or 20 years, but I definitely see this there being a lot of value in it. And I so maybe not 15 years, maybe 20 or 25 years, but I see us moving in that direction, having looked at a lot of this.
And I'm not saying the data is not valuable, and it won't enhance care, and it won't enhance population health, and the ability to, I completely agree with you, we're completely aligned there. I guess what I was responding to was the person you were quoting, saying that basically you won't need physicians because, and somebody said it in the panel earlier, the previous panel, basically you won't need physicians in 15 years because, you know, you'll be able to go online and come and tell your surgeon what surgery you need. Sorry, I think that's nuts. I mean, you know, and by the way, if I'm the surgeon, I'm not going to operate on that. I'm going to operate on what I think is right. If you want to do it, fine, go someplace else.
But data's going to change the physician-patient relationship.
With 100%, yes.
Well, we have about 15 minutes left, 10 to 15 minutes, and I'd like to keep the level of rigor alive. So I think this is a good point to open up to questions from the audience, and I think we'll probably have time for maybe 2 to 3, and feel free to, I think, direct questions to a particular panelist or to the group as a whole. So, I saw your hand up. Diagnostics, yeah. Yeah. So did everyone hear the question? I'll just repeat that quickly in case folks can't hear. So the question was, how will a company like Theranos that's offering point of care diagnostics, how will that cascade into this bigger question of big data? And then we'll get to the second one after.
I think it's a really good question. Right now, one of the major challenges, and we didn't really get to this, is the siloed nature of data in healthcare and the lack of interoperability. And I think Daniel mentioned it in a sense of, it's actually in the interests of a lot of the big healthcare provider organizations and the big healthcare IT organizations, the software vendors, to keep that data siloed at this point. So adding the Theranos data or whatever it might be, the wearable data, you know, your Fitbit or whatever, is not at this point easy, it's challenging.
Yeah.
But I think that the government, through the Meaningful Use Program, is starting to demand that challenge be met, right? The interoperability specifications are getting in Meaningful Use 2, and then in the draft of Meaningful Use 3, are actually kind of starting to address that. And then quickly, I'll answer your question about the $50 versus the $5. If I have your health record, I know a lot more about you than just your social security number. And I can therefore use that to impersonate your identity and, you know, take your money or whatever else. That's why.
I'd also like to jump in for that question. Part of the approach we're taking is we have an open API, and anybody can connect into that API and push data to that API. So you can build something. We're talking to genetics companies, and they want to push the data to doctors. So they're looking at themselves sort of like labs. Even the lab companies are looking at genetics, and they're looking at how do we push this into EHRs. So they're approaching our company and saying, how do we push this data in? And it's not that complicated to push it in. I think if you take the approach that you sort of have an open ecosystem and you allow them to get that data in some fashion, it's really interesting. It can be as simple as like a PDF file where you know, when you get your lab, a lot of the times it's just a PDF file, right? And you just kind of read that. So the genomics companies are thinking, how do we get the most critical data in that one document so doctors can read it? Because they can't read all of what's in there. It's actually very confusing. So they're thinking, how do we leverage DrChrono's API, but we want to make it usable data. So when I talk to them, they're thinking, how do we get the most interesting data in there so the doctor can look at that and say, I understand within seconds what's wrong, or what could potentially be wrong, you know, or what's going on with this patient.
I would summarize that as standardization. Sorry to jump in, but I think the same point applies for aggregating or making the data from a Fitbit or similar product useful to the physician, because he or she doesn't want to have to translate that into some other format before that data becomes useful, right. I would imagine.
Right, plus what's a physician going to do with, you know, 70 days of Fitbit data?
Right.
I mean, just all dumped on them and said, you know, here's how many steps in some long list of all the last days since they saw you. I mean, that's not going to work.
Well, you could have I mean, the way that we think about it is, don't not hide that data, but have it be unapproved, un-FDA approved data.
Right.
That the doctor can say, well, I see that this patient hasn't walked at all. He hasn't used that Fitbit I recommended at all, so there's something.
You've got to think about ways to present that data, not just as a list of 70 days worth of data, but as, you know, here's how that person varies. On the weekends they do more, during the week they do less, you know, during this week they didn't do very much. So that rather than having the physician having to go through it, this is where I think that the technology can really aid the physician to highlight those interesting kernels of information within the quote data. Data is not information.
Yeah. I believe there's a company called Curious that's looking to standardize that piece. So whether you're looking at Fitbit content or from a competing product, the output is the same. But yeah, that'll be interesting to see how it evolves going forward. Did you have a comment?
Yeah, I was just going to say, with the healthcare space, I don't think you're going to have one EHR. You're going to have one formal EHR from the provider, but you're going to have all these other data sets. You've got a genomics data set, your personal home data set, and your Fitbit data set. And, you know, the analytics challenge is, how do we now integrate that into one integrated patient?
Great.
And I just came back from Europe. One of they look at us as a little bit nuts, because everybody in Europe, depending on which country you're in, has a single healthcare ID number. Not a social security number, that's a separate number. But they have a number that just for their healthcare. And that makes this integration a heck of a lot easier, right? We don't have that, nor do I think we're going to go in that direction. It's just politically not feasible.
Great. Well, we have 5 minutes left, so I'll take one more question. I saw your hand in the front here. So it was a two-part question, first looking at the ownership question around data, which as an example was a big issue in the recent Castlight IPO, and secondly, around visualization of that. What does that look like going forward, and what should we expect? Does anyone want to initiate?
So this is actually, I think, a very complicated question, says. But on a personal note, I think when it comes to my personal data, like my genome, my health history, as an individual, I think I should own that. I should have the ownership of that. When it comes to other things, for example, when it comes to what predictions are to be made, what you are making a prognosis, right? If you are making what type of diseases will I develop, that is something where you can say, okay, that the company or whoever is the service provider, they have some say, but ultimately once they, then the, you just move the goalpost after you have the proposal and how much can they, so these are, I think, some, I think this is a very complicated question with many dimensions.
You know, I think there's a lot of, I think that's right, there are different levels to look at it. Look, from a legal point of view, it's your data. In the United States, in every state, you own that data, and it's supposed to be provided to you, you know, at your request. What does that mean, though, to own your data? What does that mean that you own it? I mean, it's kind of amorphous. And so.